Welcome to this 23-part series on the Book of Revelation and Understanding Revelation. This is a series of Bible studies, and for these Bible studies, you will need a Bible, paper and pen for taking notes. So let's get started. Part 9, Revelation's Thousand Years of Peace. We've heard the word millennium so much at the turn of the century. I'm sure it's in all our vocabularies. As you know, just as 10 years is a decade and 100 years is a century, 1,000 is a millennium. Coming as it does from two Latin words, milli, meaning thousand, and annus, meaning year. We're all tired of hearing about the Y2K crisis that never happened. And by this time, we're pretty well accustomed to writing dates correctly with the year 2000. But what about the Bible millennium? What does the book of Revelation teach about that? Actually, the specific word millennium appears not at all in the entire Bible. But the idea of a special thousand-year period does. In fact, the expression of 1,000 years appears 6 times. Once in each verse from Revelation 20, verse 2, to verse 7. It's an important concept, for the millennium is, in a sense, God's timetable to final events. It reveals the schedule God plans to use when He brings down the curtain on the drama of this world's history. God says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 40, "Let all things be done decently and in order." And the Lord, being a God of order, has everything organized in a beautiful way. For instance, any study of the future must account for 4 groups of people: the righteous living when Christ comes, and the wicked living, and the righteous already dead, and the wicked dead. The Bible millennium neatly accounts for all 4 groups. Now let's consider events under 3 headings. Events before, events during, and events after the millennium. Events before the millennium. Event number 1. The mark of the beast is given. In Revelation chapter 13, verse 16 to 17, the Antichrist beast enforces his mark with coercive threats. Revelation 14, verse 9 to 10, but God warns us against taking it. Event number 2, our probation closes. Revelation 22, verse 11 to 12, Jesus accepts each one's decision as final and says He'll return quickly. Revelation 15, verse 1, and verse 8, 7 angels pour out the wrath of God. Revelation 16, 1 to 17, the 7 last plagues punish those who have the mark of the beast. Event number 3, the 7 last plagues fall. Revelation 15, verses 1 and 8, 7 angels pour out the wrath of God. Revelation 16, verse 1 to 17, the 7 last plagues punish those who have the mark of the beast. Event number 4, the second coming of Christ is spectacular. Matthew 24, verse 30 to 31, Christ returns with power and great glory to gather His faithful people. Matthew 25, verse 31, when He comes in His glory and all the holy angels accompany Him. Revelation 1, 7, as Christ gathers His redeemed in the rapture, every eye shall see Him. Event number 5, the righteous dead are resurrected. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, the dead believers in Christ rise first, before the living faithful. Revelation 20, verse 6, the first resurrection is for those blessed and holy who are with him, Christ, for 1,000 years. The word first implies a second, and there are 2 resurrections, 1,000 years apart. John chapter 5, verse 28 to 29. The resurrection of life is opposed to the resurrection of damnation, 1,000 years later. Event number 6. The righteous living are caught up. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. The living saints are then caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Event number 7. The wicked living, when Christ comes, are struck dead. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 to 10. Christ will take vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 8. Christ will destroy the wicked with the brightness of his coming. In Isaiah chapter 13, verse 9, the Lord will lay the land desolate and destroy the sinners out of it. Isaiah 66, verse 15 to 16. Behold, the slain of the Lord shall be many. Events during the millennium. Event number 8. On earth, Satan is bound, with no one left to tempt. Revelation 20, verse 1 to 3 and verse 7. Satan is bound with a great chain and cast into the bottomless pit, till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things he must be released a little while. Are 1, the great chain, which binds Satan, and 2, the bottomless pit, which forms his prison, literal? The devil is real and literal enough. Jesus himself said, "I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven." Luke chapter 10, verse 18. But the angel Lucifer, who made himself into the devil called Satan, is a supernatural being. As Paul put it, "We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against spiritual wickedness in high places." See Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Simple reason tells us that no actual, literal chain or pit or prison could secure a supernatural being. More important, sacred scripture tells us the same thing. One day after sailing across the Sea of Galilee, they, Jesus and his disciples, came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs. And no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains. And the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces. See Mark chapter 5, verse 1 to 9. Ask yourself, if a devil-possessed man could easily break apart a chain with superhuman strength, it is likely that the prince of devils himself could be bound with one. So what kind of chain is it that God uses to bind Satan? It's a chain of circumstances which binds the devil more securely than any literal chain ever forged. Note the circumstances in which Satan finds himself at this time. In the first place, all the righteous who were unwilling to listen to him anyway have been taken to heaven, and all the wicked have been struck dead. Thus the entire earth is depopulated, with no one left for Satan to tempt. Old Testament prophets foresaw this unique situation. See Jeremiah chapter 25, verse 33. The slain wicked shall not be lamented or gathered or buried. for there are no survivors around to do any of these things. Isaiah 26, verse 21, when the Lord returns, the earth shall no more cover her slain. Isaiah 24, verse 1, verse 3, verse 22, the Lord makes the earth empty, the land shall be utterly emptied. How many effective this chain of circumstances is. Satan is securely bound, chained by circumstances beyond his control. But what is the bottomless pit? The Greek word translated bottomless pit is abyssus, from which we get our English word abyss. Modern Bible versions, like the Amplified Bible, the NASB, the NEB, the NIV, the TEV, and other translate bottomless pit in Revelation 20, verse 1, as abyss. Abyssus is exactly the same word the Greek translation of the Old Testament uses in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, where it says the earth was without form and void. The prophet Jeremiah directed divine light on this question when, centuries ago, he looked down the corridor of time with the eye of inspiration and testified. Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 23 to 27. The earth is desolate, without form and void, with no human inhabitant. What period of history was Jeremiah seeing when he wrote, "Lo, there was no man"? We might think it was at the start of creation week, because 1. There was no man before God formed Adam, the first man, and because 2. Jeremiah said the earth was without form and void, which was true at that time. But although those two clues fit that time period, we note that God placed a third clue in this passage which does not fit. Jeremiah says he saw all the cities broken down. This vision couldn't possibly be of the beginning of creation week, for man didn't build cities before he was even created. The only other time in human history when prophecy could describe the earth as having no man is during the millennium, while the earth is depopulated of all living people, empty, as we read before. At that time, all the cities will be broken down, completely leveled from the devastation of the final one of the seven last plagues, which brings the most terrific earthquake ever and pulverizing hail. Event number 9. In heaven, the saints assist in the judgment. Revelation 20, verse 4. The redeemed sat on thrones, and judgment was committed to them. Luke 22, verse 30. Jesus desires that ye may sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 23. The saints shall judge the world and angels, the angels who fell with Lucifer. Even human legal proceedings don't dispose of a case in a flash. The whole process has several stages. First, there's the investigation of all pertinent facts we call a trial. Second, there's the rendering of a decision we call a verdict. Next, there's often an assessment of the verdict we call a judicial review. Finally, there is a carrying out of the verdict, which we call the execution of the sentence. The same process is seen in mankind's final judgment. The first two steps take place in heaven before Jesus returns. See Daniel chapter 7, verse 9 and 10. For step 1, the investigation or trial must precede step 2, when Christ comes, the execution of the wicked final death sentence will take place after the 1,000 years are finished. But step 3 is where the redeemed saints in heaven are granted the privilege of conducting a judicial review of the cases of the wicked who lie dead on earth. God knows that because some people are not saved, they'll be missed by the saints. Yet, he wants no heavy hearts in heaven. So God will allow us to ask any questions about his decision as to why some are not saved in heaven, such as, how come Aunt Martha and Grandfather aren't here? They were such good people. Yes, and how about Pastor Jones and Father Brown? God made a mistake if they're lost. Then an angel will lead the inquirers to heaven's record books, now lying open to examination, and sadly reveal the unforgiven sins. Sins not blotted out, unknown to the world, unknown even to the close friends and loved ones. God is too wise to allow even a trace of a doubt to linger in anyone's mind about his justice. Though the wicked from all ages suffered the first death common to all men, God will not destroy them by the second death in the lake of fire until this review of his judgment is completed. In other words, God makes sure that even number 14 will not take place until even number 9 has been thoroughly completed. Events after the millennium. Event number 10. The wicked are resurrected, so Satan is loosed. Revelation 20, verse 3, verse 5, and verse 7. Those, blessed and holy, had part in the first resurrection. But the rest of the dead, the wicked, lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, for once again he has people to tempt. Event number 11. The holy city descends from God out of heaven. Revelation 21, verse 2 and verse 10. The New Jerusalem, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband, descends. Event number 12. The wicked surround God's holy city. Revelation 20, verse 7 to 9. With the wicked alive again, Satan is loosed out of his prison and goes out to deceive them, to gather them to battle against the beloved city. Event number 13. The wicked are judged before God's great white throne. Revelation 20, verse 11 to 13. Before the great white throne, the books were opened to judge the lost. Romans 14, verse 10 to 12. Every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess, and give account to God. Event number 14. The wicked are destroyed by fire. Revelation 20, verse 9, and 14, and 15. When the wicked surround the holy city to attack it, fire comes down from God out of heaven and devours them. This lake of fire is the second death. Revelation 21, and verse 8. The wicked of every description have their part in this lake of fire. Event number 15. The earth is cleansed by fire and made new. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10 to 13. The elements shall melt with fervent heat. All these things shall be dissolved. Revelation 21, verse 1 and verse 5. But he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. Psalms 37, verse 11, and Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. The blessed redeemed shall inherit the earth made new. Isaiah 65, verse 17, verse 21 to 25. The redeemed will build houses, plant vineyards, and enjoy the new earth. Isaiah 66, verse 22 to 23. On the glorious new earth will come to worship God from one Sabbath to another. Our Heavenly Father has so much He longs to teach us. Think of each Bible session as one in a series of steps leading upward, a series of lessons from heaven. May we learn our lessons well, so we in turn can teach others.